Hello and welcome to this discussion between myself, Lobna Hassan, and Sebastian Deterding and Troy Innocent. So I am a postdoctoral researcher at the Center of Excellence in Game Culture Studies at Tampere University. And the reason we're here today is that very recently, Sebastian and I and our two co-authors, Harviainen and Hamari, wrote a paper on fighting post-truth politics with storification. So we thought that it would be a nice idea to discuss what storification is in light of post-truth and a lot of other topics. And we thought it would be great to be joined by Troy Innocent, reflecting on kind of the practical side of citizen engagement when it comes to games and narratives and so on. So let's start maybe with Sebastian first. Do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. Hi there. Thanks for inviting me and organizing this. I'm Sebastian Deterding. I'm a professor for digital creativity at the University of York. There are lots of universities of York. This is the one in the north of England, in the United Kingdom, not in Canada. We have rain. We don't have snow.
Nice. Thank you. And Troy, do you want to tell us a bit about yourself?
Yeah, sure. Also, thanks for inviting me. This sounds like a really interesting topic and something I have been thinking about a lot, actually, last year. So, my name is Troy Innocent. I'm based at RMIT University in Melbourne, Australia, where I'm an urban play scholar and artist game maker. So I write about games, but I also make games. Last year and a half has been interesting because I've been making city-based games in public space very sporadically, given that we've been in lockdown for half of that time at least.
We can't easily access cities anymore.
That's right.
Yeah. But yeah, so the basic idea of the paper is that we were thinking about post-truth politics and what we're seeing in terms of political leaders using narratives of us versus them, basically, to mobilize people. So this was back in 2018, I guess, when we were working on the paper. This was and still is a popular way of getting citizens involved. And it's not always great because we've seen that it leads to division in different societies. It leads to people usually leaning to one extreme or another and then not very easily changing their opinion when engaging in discussions and so on. And part of these practices, post-truth practices, has been also fake information, fake news and misinformation and all that kind of stuff. And people have been thinking that, you know, in order to fight fake news, let's ask people to fact check more and to look into evidence more. But usually this becomes not very engaging for people or boring, in other words. And the idea of the paper came about that, hey, as much as narratives and emotions are engaging when used in post-truth politics, they can also be used to engage people with information and factual, you know, kind of evidence for them to base their opinion on. And this is where the idea came about of discussing storification in the context of citizen engagement. So Sebastian, I relied a lot on your conceptualization of storification. So can you tell me more about like what is it and how it's different from narratives, like just simply telling a story or something like that? Because this is a question that I struggle to understand myself.
Sure. So my interest, similar to Troy and similar to you, comes out of, right, how can we take everyday activities or situations or goals and use playful design or game design in order to further these goals or make certain activities more engaging, right? That sometimes then goes under the header of gameful design, gamification, playful design, what have you. And if you look into what people have been doing and how they kind of split the field, you find they talk about different kinds of design strategies or different kinds of design elements. And then very often a thing that pops up is narrative or story or avatars. And it's usually very shallow. It usually kind of stays at that, just to say, you want to engage people, give them an avatar and tell a story. So what I've tried to do in a 2016 paper is make believe in gameful and playful design out there, open access. was to think more systematically through, okay, what are the kind of different strategies in which we've used make-believe or pretend play? So, wrapping the world into fictional as-if meanings. This fly swat is not a fly swat, it is a scepter. And I am not a kid on the way home to school, I am a king. And what we're doing right now is not walking home, we're ruling over the citizens that we're passing by as we're promenading along here. So these kinds of everyday pretend play activities that we already see in kids and that we find then manifested in movies, books, but also games. Basically, this kind of wrapping things into make-believe. And what I try to do is, okay, if this is the broad field of cultural practices, can we actually analyze and decompose them into different aspects? And the way that I kind of came to decompose them is, well, there is this sort of fundamental layer, which is simply theming something, so dressing something up in a different form. So this is what we see in theme parks or theme restaurants, where the whole restaurant is suddenly dressed up as if it were a dungeon, or it's dressed up as if it were a clinic or something like that. And then, your menu becomes a clipboard or something like that. So this dressing up is one thing. And then the next step in kind of a letter of make-believe design is from just dressing up and relabeling one thing into another thing, is to actually connect these different things with basic elements of story. So basically, right, a narrated sequence of events that make sense of these things. So, right, again, it's not just that this fly swat is a scepter and that I am a king, not a kid. I will then also tell stories about, connective stories about how I come to be on this street and how the scepter comes into my hand, etc. And so storification, we find that in a lot of particular kind of cultural heritage interventions or designs where people are going on a trail or they walk through a museum, and then they might be met by another character who tells them a story about how the different things that they're visiting hanging together and what their role is in walking through this ancient ruin or something like that. So that's kind of storification as a particular subset of the set of design strategies that we have to tie into make-believe and thereby, again, touch people's emotions by making things emotionally resonant with stories that we connect to, evoking curiosity, surprise, and suspense, right? If we have a well-structured narrative where surprising things happen or we would like to know what happens next, empathizing with certain things by, right, the story putting us into people's shoes, we're embodying certain other characters, or by relating a story about people, characters that we encounter in the world, and telling us their background stories and thereby maybe bringing us closer to them.
So the way that I understand storification is that we're sort of creating a narrative and we're relaying it on top of real world events or so on. So how would that be different from a leader going on stage and saying, hey, there are these evil people who are trying to ruin our country or whatever, and we need to protect ourselves? So I guess, is storification in a way similar to post-truth, or is it different, or what do you think?
So I think it's similar, it's different. It's similar as in, like, as we make the fundamental argument in the paper, we are narrative animals, right? So this goes back to arguments by Jerome Bruner and others who say, no, basically the way that we process and make sense of the world is in narrative structures. We think literally when we perceive the world and we make sense of the world in narrative structures. So there is no way escaping that. No matter what you do, you will implicitly or explicitly be telling stories. And if you just ask is kind of the classic rationalist idea of politics, if you just try to avoid telling stories and instead just double down on facts and evidence and rational argument, de facto you will still be telling stories, you will just be telling crappy stories more or less. So on some extent they're all the same, because they're basically saying, no, stories is how we make sense of the world, so let's just be deliberate about that and not just tell crappy stories. So that's kind of where the similarity is. I think where the difference is On the one hand, a lot of storification is happening under a more or less explicit layer or framing of as if, right? So you recognize that this is a fictional or an as if story. So you're not saying that I'm telling you a factual story here about evil immigrants, et cetera, but rather you might lean into something that's a thinly clad metaphor, allegory, or fantasy, but thereby you're not necessarily making factual claims. So that's the first possible thing. The other is, no, we're doing this intentionally. We're intentionally using narrative structures here, and we're intentionally telling story. But unlike post-truth politicians, we do that with a honest, sincere, good faith commitment to truth and fact. So right, we're not taking, in Harry G. Frankfurt's notion, we're not taking a bullshitter's position where we say, we don't care whether anything what we tell is true or not, we just care about the effects, right? The storification position is, no, we care about the effects, that's why we tell stories, but at the same time, we have a moral commitment to a notion of truth and fact, right? However then epistemologically you construct that, but still there is honesty, there is sincerity, there is a commitment behind it.
Right. And I'm going to get back to this point on the moral commitment, because I have a story of my own to tell in connection to that. But before this, Troy, could you please tell us a bit about, I know that you do a lot of work on getting people to play within cities. So the concept of adults and play is something you touch a lot on. And so what do you think about this idea that of narratives or as a way of maybe suspending disbelief, or so that people can engage more with cities? Does that work in real life, or what happens when you try it on ground?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Anyone who's designed a game for adults to play, particularly adults in public space, knows that there's a huge challenge. Like, why should I play? Am I going to be embarrassed? What do I do? And having a framework or a narrative framework around that gives people a way into that experience, so that they, something that's recognizable, that they can latch onto. When I was teaching in pervasive game design lab a few years ago, there was all the students were coming in, and often my brief was, the university campus is your playground, you've got to get your fellow students to play these games. And students would sometimes come up with these hugely complex games with well-balanced mechanics and all kinds of fantastic strategic opportunities, but they didn't have any story around them. And then when they took them out into the wild, people just couldn't get it. As you're just saying, Stephen, giving someone a sword and saying, "Yeah, hold this sword," they immediately latch onto, "Oh, I must be fighting for something. I must have some purpose." And so that kind of purpose is super important. This is my experience also in cities. So one of the projects that I've been working on over the last couple of years involves working with a theatre group, so who are inherently kind of engaged in kind of telling stories or building story worlds, more the point. And the way that we're working with this in terms of engaging people with public space, and because our goal with this project is for them to uncover the layers of history and experience and emotion in the urban environment, rather than just be like a smartphone zombie and move from point A to B. So to actually get them to be immersed in place and connected to place. And so we're creating these stories that they listen to with headphones that unfold in relation to what they're seeing on the street. So that it's this kind of running commentary, but it's also partly poetic, so it's opening up the possibility for them to imagine something else, and eventually each of these 3 to 5 minute audio experiences that they listen to. lead to an augmented reality encounter that lead to an augmented reality. Yeah.
I think maybe Sebastian turning off his video.
I would suggest we turn off our video because Troy, for me also, you became choppy in when you started to talk about the audio experience with headphones. So if you want to repeat that, and then hopefully if we turn the cameras off, the audio signal.
Okay, yeah, sure. So maybe I'll pick up. So yes, from where I remember to go start with. So it's like you were saying before, Sebastian, about you have to give players a purpose. You need to, so back when I was designing games in the Pervasive Game Design Lab, even these complex, well-balanced games were given purpose just by a simple theming, like as you were saying. So giving a player a sword, and so suddenly they have a purpose, I must be fighting for something. And so over the last 2 years, I've been working with a theatre group and who are building these story worlds about public space. And our goal, we're working in Melbourne, is to get players to engage with the layers of the city. So not just be smartphone zombies moving from point A to B, but to observe and be in place. And so they hear these story, these narratives that unfold that sometimes reference architecture, sometimes reference place names, sometimes reference what was there before, for example, wetlands, sometimes talk about, you know, the future. So they're kind of engaging, opening up the city and opening up the player's imagination. And eventually the player, after 3 to 5 minute audio track, is led into a particular location, a laneway or a public square. And they engage with an augmented reality experience that then unfolds that in something that they play. So then they become part of the story, part of the story world. And what I think is really interesting about this approach and about narrative in general is kind of looking at how we come at narrative now and I guess recent history. And I'm not a scholar of this area, but certainly with kind of dealing with media such as games and so forth, you can see how stories, which used to be things that were performed, either through oral storytelling traditions or, you know, through, before, everything got encoded into books, for example, stories had a very different mode of delivery. And I think there's been a kind of shift back into that. This started with, you know, things like transmedia, where you're able to kind of act out a story world either through, you know, toys or games or whatever it might be. And then more recently with things like alternate reality games and location-based games that situate story in place, and that kind of connection of the kind of semiotic language of stories, because that's partly how they work, is they work with all these blocks of meaning that collide together, that are familiar, that, you know, activate meaning within our brain with a kind of phenomenological experience of place. I think that's a really, really interesting kind of collision, and that's what I like to work with in cities.
What I really like about what you brought up is the aspect of embarrassment when you're playing in public, right? So when you're an adult, then you usually have certain kinds of role expectations, how you are to behave as an adult, and just playing around or whacking about with foam swords or something like that is not something that is considered to be adult appropriate behavior. I think what that points to is that in any of these kinds of interventions, there were multiple levels of stories going on at the same time that have different kind of impacts. So one of the impacts that you describe is literally, so we wrap a kind of fictional or historical narrative around the world that we see, and that changes how we experience it, how we make sense of it. But then there is kind of another level of story here, which is the story itself about the activity that we're doing here. And in an analysis of these kinds of instances of public play, I pointed to how these kinds of stories as adults often give us alibis that allow us to engage in this activity without feeling awkward or embarrassed. So my favorite example is the Boston Santa Speedo Run, where grown men run through the Boston winter in nothing but Santa hats and Speedos, which usually would be a hugely embarrassing activity. But the fact that it is a charity run, that you say, okay, this is a spectacle with which we gather money for AIDS, HIV, or similar kind of medical causes, suddenly means that this is a noble cause where you as an adult don't have to be embarrassed. In fact, the fact that you publicly embarrass yourself by putting on a Speedo and a Santa hat is a noble thing rather than an embarrassing thing. So a lot of the kind of designs that we do need to tell this other, this alibi story about why we're doing the thing that we're doing in order for us to be able to engage in it, which in the paper, we then get to a third level of narrative, which we call embedded or embodied narrative, where we say the very fact that this kind of thing exists, so that this kind of play in public or this center speedo run also tells a story, right? So if a system like Community Planet puts you into different roles in its narrative where you together go through a public planning exercise for a city, then that tells us a story about your city council who's organizing these things. They're very modern and forward-looking and not old-fashioned, and they actually care about your opinion. So apart from the kind of the overt narrative, fictional or not, that we tell or that we wrap experiences into, we have all of these other layers of more or less explicit or implicit storytelling going on that do other things in order to make the experience work as a whole, right? Get us less embarrassed, for instance, or willing to engage in the first place, but also then implicitly, again, communicate certain things. And that communication might even be the major message, right? So one of the complaints about a lot of civic engagement activities is that they're just tokenist. But from a certain kind of narrative analysis perspective, you could say, yeah, that's sort of one of the main effects, for good or ill, that they're shooting at, which is to signal, to tell the story that your city cares about your opinion, even if in the sad case that then after the activity just gets shelved away and never to be looked at again.
Yeah, and I think the really interesting thing there is getting players across that threshold, because once they're in, then the experience tells the story rather than it being told by a narrator. In fact, they're in the story world and they're kind of engaging with, you know, the three I's, their immersion, interaction and imagination. And I think a really interesting idea to throw into the mix here also is Bernie de Koven's concept of the infinite playground, the fact that, you know, everything can be imagined in another way. And in fact, the entire, as you said at the beginning, Sebastian, anything can be turned into a game just by given another meaning or another context or situated in another place. If that's something to do with city planning, I guess the only thing is, and I think this is well articulated in your paper as well, it has to have an impact at the end to kind of close the loop.
I'm kind of wondering, Troy, if you, because you have implementations of like a play situation implemented in the city, and I'm kind of wondering how people would interpret the existence of this thing that invites them to play with the city. Like, do they see it as the city trying to be more open or more inclusive or something like that, or encourage more citizen interaction with the city, or do they see it as this is the work of researchers who are maybe interested in this, but it's not necessarily something that's going to become part of the city? Or how do citizens interpret these implementations?
I guess most of the projects that I've engaged with so far have been within the framework of public art, and so therefore the way that people come to them is as a, you know, a theatre experience that happens on the street, or a public artwork that has a narrative around it, or a participatory performance. And so it's not very overt that there is a kind of kind of purpose. And in fact, this is something that always talking about with other designers and colleagues that I'm working with is, you know, once you instrumentalize play, it just becomes, you know, really, really difficult to maintain, you know, immersion and get people to engage with it in imaginative ways. And so the framework that I really like to work with is this idea of the city as the laboratory, as a kind of a play space. And in fact, that's one of the goals in the work that I do, is to open people up to that experience, because people can often see cities as just really monolithic and unchangeable, unmovable, whereas actually they're quite mutable, and particularly in terms of their social fabric and digital layers and all of the more transient aspects of them. They're really quite fluid. And so I guess when making playful interventions, they're really staged as playful interventions. So that in contrast with the two projects that are discussed in the paper, there's not an invitation to participate in some kind of urban planning or urban design. The approach is more through observation. So, for example, I'm working with an urban designer at the moment, and who studies spontaneous play in cities. And so what we're planning in the current project is to make a number of interventions and then just observe how people engage with them. And so, for example, changing this, something that's happening a lot in cities over the past year has been temporary changes to the streetscape to allow for outdoor dining or, you know, more bike lanes or whatever it might be. And this is largely due to the impact of the pandemic, but it presents an opportunity as well to say, well, putting kind of the hat of a speculative designer on, you can say, well, what if this whole street was green? And what if it was closed to traffic? And we can kind of do a temporary intervention and see how pedestrians react, whether they engage or whether that area is too busy and they don't engage at all. They're just kind of rushing from place to place. So kind of trying to get a gauge of what the nature of that place is.
I really like that approach, and it sort of makes me think that what you're addressing there is not necessarily right immediate participation in city planning, but it's sort of dealing with the preconditions or conditions of possibility before you want to participate. Right, you need to have a lived sense, right? So as a psychologist, you would talk about self-efficacy, right? You need to have a sense that you can actually change things and that things are mutable. So to some extent, this kind of play with the city sounds a bit like, I don't know, Brechtian theater, right? Where the V effect, the Verfremdungseffekt was originally, okay, I stage things in such a weird and sparse way that people realize that everything on stage is staged, and therefore your social life is also changed. And that means you can change it, right? It's just as mutable as the objects that we put on a stage. And to some extent, it sounds like your interventions are about, well, by playing around imaginatively, speculatively with the city around you, you just get a firsthand lived experience. Oh no, the city is actually far more mutable. And thinking about imagining alternative desirable futures is actually something possible and enjoyable for me as an individual citizen. It's nothing that is out of reach.
Yeah, exactly. And then if you get people into that play state, as you were saying before, things happen that they wouldn't have, say, articulated if they were at a town hall meeting or being asked to fill out a survey or whatever, because they're just doing it. They're just kind of there playing with the possibilities as well.
The interesting question for me there, as in the other examples or interventions that we looked at, is the same that you asked. So does this then have impact in the end, right? So particularly with pervasive games or play in public, one of my concerns is, okay, that's a lovely experience while you're having it. But afterwards, we just basically, like after a carnival, right, we just sweep the streets of the confetti and then no trace remains, or the people that participate are people that are already sort of in the hipster in crowd who are into these kinds of activities. So they get a bit more reinforcement. Oh yeah, this is the kind of thing that I like doing, but it's not necessarily in kind of the populace at large moving the needle on something like efficacy or imagination. So do you have any indications or any, I don't know, design insight into how to make this kind of impact more likely, even if it's, but if you say, let's be careful not to instrumentalize play, but if there are some political hopes attached to it, right? So how do you make them more likely while not immediately instrumentalizing play?
Yeah, I can give some anecdotal examples, but first of all, it is a really interesting question and something that we have been looking to explore ourselves, and particularly in connection with the project I was talking about before, 64 Ways of Being. We've developed an impact study which is still rolling out. You know, it's been slowed down a little due to the pandemic and access to players and so forth, but we wanted to answer that question around what was the impact on players. Did they change their perception of the city? And then also, and this is kind of further down the track, it's really probably a 3-year study, working with local government to see if, say, through placemaking audits, if there's any change to the perception of place more generally as a result of these playful interventions. So to get some evidence around that, because mostly it's anecdotal, and mostly when we've been looking at other examples, it is still anecdotal. But I can share one story about a project that we made at RMIT, I think 2 years ago now, which was sharing stories of a Boonwurrung elder, Ngawi Dr. Carolyn Briggs, who's an Indigenous a person who was at the university at the time, and she recorded a number of stories of Indigenous stories and knowledge, which was then turned into a series of audio walks and experiences. And so we created this as a prototype to share her knowledge and to experiment with, you know, experience of place and situating Indigenous knowledge in a contemporary context. And it was played as a prototype, but there's been a real interest in that project afterwards because people have found that it has changed their perception of place. And so while there's no evidence, we haven't done interviews or something, this is kind of really a project that has just kind of built momentum on its own. The anecdotal evidence, you know, talking with players who've been through this experience, is that it has changed their perception of place, which is one of the goals that we had with that project.
Interesting. I wanted to go back to the point on ethics of storification and of playful interventions at large, because one of the key feedback that we received when I first presented this paper at a sort of a seminar was that when we introduce play or storification to cities or to citizen involvement with governance and so on, that it is a way of manipulating the citizens into participating. And again, back to the question of, so how is what you're proposing different from post-truth politics and fake news and so on? There is, of course, huge responsibility on whoever designs these playful interventions or storification to be, as Sebastian said, to be factual, to somehow advance public good. But then what is public good and how to be ethical about the interventions that we're discussing?
Okay, I'm happy to open. I'm really interested in Troy's view as well. So my first response to that kind of critique is always to go back to Paul Watzlawick, the communication researcher in the 50s and 60s, who was massively involved in kind of systemic therapy. And he has this wonderful statement, you cannot not communicate, right? So even if you stay silent, you say something by being silent in a certain context. And in that text, little known, he then also basically expands on that and says, you cannot not influence. So the idea that there is any form of communication that is not influencing other people or trying to influence other people is naive. Whatever we do or choose not to do in the context that we are has effects or impacts on other people. So I think the critique, oh, you're manipulating people, is to some extent sort of not aware of the fact that any form of communication or non-communication, any form of shaping the city space or choosing not to shape it has impacts on people and is a deliberate choice. So, okay, what makes a particular choice good or not good by some ethical standard? And there, I think you're just, I don't know, opening up the good old can of worms. Well, what ethics do you subscribe to? And I don't know, I sort of kind of come down on a Habermasian side, and your mileage may differ. You may come down somewhere else. And I would say, well, in a secular pluralist society, we discuss amongst us what we consider to be the public values, hopefully in a more or less power-free discourse, and then come hopefully to some form of agreement on that, or at least an agreement to disagree. So there is no predetermined book that you can open and say, this is ethical, this is unethical. But then again, right, I'm a secularist, so I don't go back to religious texts and say, this is evil, this is not evil. I think the specifics of or narrative interventions that are worthy of ethical consideration is usually tied to a value of transparency and consent. To what extent am I as a participant aware what I am participating in, and have I consented into that or not? Or is it something that I don't have a choice whether to participate in or not, or where I'm not fully transparently aware of what is going on and how it's working, right? So there are quite a number of kind of life action role plays, subtle mobs, flash mobs, and similar activities where I might become an unwitting participant in something. And don't feel like I have a choice in saying that. So that's where transparency, autonomy, or consent are the kind of values that I then often see get kind of touched on when people discuss the ethics of these kinds of interventions.
It's kind of like the basic research ethics that whenever you're doing a study, you have to inform people of what you're doing. So that makes sense.
Yeah, and if it's very weird or novel, which for a lot of people these kinds of things are, then I think there is kind of an extra duty, right? If I'm living in Rio de Janeiro and I see the carnival passing by, I know from lived experience over decades what this is and how it works. Mm-hmm. If suddenly people around me come dressed in weird colors or just, again, in Speedos or Santa hats, and I have no context for knowing what's going on here, right? And they suddenly dance around with me, that might just feel, again, overwhelming to me. Mm-hmm. And then again, touch onto my, okay, I want to have sovereignty about myself and I want to know what I am participating in.
So it's a really good point. I think I'm thinking about de Koven's the well-played game, and point he makes around play being voluntary and that being really important, something that you choose to participate in. And you can also choose to perhaps modify or change, so you have that feeling that you're part of it, that you're not being manipulated. And I think actually this is really interesting in terms of post-truth politics, because the trick that really happens there often is that so inherently most people know that, you know, politicians can't be trusted, and you've kind of best position is really just to try and listen to policies and, you know, choose the best, what seems best for you, and you make a kind of educated choice based on that. But the trick that that happens in post-truth politics, and this is the whole basis of you know, the populist strategy, is that you start to feel like the politician, the leader that you're is telling your story, that you're kind of somehow you know, even if their policies are completely at odds with your life, or they're going to make your life worse, like create a better situation for the wealthy, and you're going to kind of lose out by paying more tax or earning less money or whatever it might be. But the illusion is that they're telling your story. And this is kind of plays into the whole tribalism that happens in politics, where people end up just saying, oh yeah, they're the good side and they're the bad side. And it becomes really, really kind of simplified. And that's how all that stuff works. But if I kind of go back to one of the examples in the paper, Run That Town, because when I saw it, I thought, oh, I've played this game. The interesting thing there was what really, I guess, changes your perception, or from my point of view, my perception was the fact that it was working with this real data. So it was working. So in my mind, I know what the Australian Bureau of Statistics is, and I know that it's neutral, or perceived to be neutral as much as it can be, and that data is truthful. You start to feel that you're having an authentic experience, and so if the experience is voluntary and you feel like you have some agency, or perhaps not to change things but to make your own decisions about the message that's being presented with you, to you, and you're not just going along for the ride, then that becomes much more palatable, I think, a better position ethically. But then, yeah, in public space, all the rules change again, because then there's, as you just pointed out, Sebastian, the potential of being embedded in an experience that perhaps you don't know what it is. And so you always have to be mindful of and watchful as well when staging these, you know, events in public space, that you're not impacting on others by perhaps moving into private space, or involving people in a game that they don't want to play, or any of those types of scenarios. And so that becomes a huge consideration. But that's also what's really interesting about public space as well, because people actually feel like they don't have permission, or they don't have the possibility to do these things. So it can be quite liberating for people as well.
I'd like to pick up the point that you made about kind of the connection to post-truth politics, because that kind of led to a reflection for me that we didn't actually write in the paper, but now that I think about it, is interesting. You could say that to some extent there is a certain morality or ethicality to being fictional that is sort of similar to being art or art based, right? So by signaling that you're fictional, or by signaling that you're a piece of art, you're suspending your claim to literal truth, right? You're literally, that's one of the understandshared frames for art or for fiction, that in a metaphorical way it can be truthful, right? It can make a more general statement about the human condition. And it might even include loads of facts. Like, so we know that Sherlock Holmes has lots of factual statements about Victorian London that are actually factually true, but we're not trusting it immediately to have to be true in that sense, in the same way that we put that kind of trust into a political speech, more or less, or into a newspaper article. So I think, again, kind of coming back to Brechtian theater, just introducing this one extra distancing, where I say, well, to some extent, my truth status is a bit suspended here, because I'm a piece of fiction, or I'm a simulation, or I'm a piece of play, or I'm a piece of art, I think potentially opens up people to question the stories that you propose more so gives them more agency in asking, well, is the story that you're telling really true or not, than it does in a classic political speech or newspaper articles, which just says, this is how it is, and I just want you to not question whatever it is that I'm presenting to you, right? So the introduction of a layer of fiction, of as if, of art, of play, invites you to question what is presented a bit more than a factual presentation, at least potentially. Like, this is, again, this is something where I would actually like to see lots of data on, because I also know in persuasion research that other people say, well, by virtue of immersing you deeply in a fictional world, you actually, to some extent, don't have enough cognitive resources available to critically question the story that is being told here. And so therefore you accept it even more unquestioningly, right? So that would be the opposite conclusion to what Jovasar just said. So that would be an interesting, I think, just, yeah, area for future inquiry.
Kind of somehow reminded me with experiments where they would make someone wear a lab coat, and then they would present you with something, and so automatically you would trust them because they are wearing a lab coat. So it kind of feels like when a political leader tells you something, well, I guess it depends on your position. Like, some people would automatically think that they don't trust politicians in general, but then maybe they are kind of wearing a lab coat that makes us believe the stories more. Whereas if something is storification and is, like both of you said, presented as a piece of art, then it is maybe more likely that people would be more active agents in their consumption of what is being communicated.
I think it would be interesting if you kind of, you do the wearing the lab coat, but then what are the kind of design strategies you use to really lean into the, hey, you shouldn't just trust me because I'm wearing a lab coat. So like, how can I make that ironic? How can I make that ostentatious? How can I make that over the top, or do something by which I undermine the authority that I acquire just by wearing a lab coat, and tell people, you shouldn't be so gullible as to just trust me because I'm wearing a lab coat here. So that would be for me an interesting, where again, I think play offers lots of opportunities, and that would be an interesting design question to then look at.
It is.
We've all internalized all of these codes about the world. And I think that's where, imaginative play can be really, can have great impact, because it can challenge those codes or even just reveal them as codes. So you realize, I do associate people wearing lab coats with, scientific facts, and maybe I shouldn't always do that because, it's used in advertising, for example, to try and sell products, or perhaps in even more overt and manipulative ways.
There is a lot still to be researched.
Yes.
Yep. But thank you very much, both of you. I'm gonna turn on my camera briefly just to thank you for being here and for this very insightful discussion. I'm gonna link the paper down below in the description, as well as links to Troy's and Sebastian's work. And thank you for listening, and goodbye.